What makes the Kurtzer School so special, our faculty, and their reflections about what they do and how that work has an impact on the lives and livelihoods and human dignity of people affected by conflict, and that personal connection that they shared with us. I think that was really profound and was really great. And over the last day and a half, we heard that a number of times when it comes to the work of President Mrs. Kurtzer, how integrated that is with different continents. They don't like silos. When they do conflict resolution, they link it with health. When they do health, they link it with human rights. When they do human rights, they link that with democracy work, right? So, and one of the themes, and in fact, it was mentioned in the last panel by Professor Goppin, is the whole health and well-being, psychological well-being, and particularly the work of Rosalynn Kurtzer in this area. So I'm delighted to welcome two distinguished academics and higher education leaders to unpack this particular area for us. So first of all, let me introduce Melissa Perry, who serves as the Dean of the College of Public Health at George Mason University. And I must say, we are so proud that this is the first public health college here in Virginia. And she's a trained epidemiologist. She is renowned for her work in occupational and environmental epidemiology. During 21-22, she was a Fulbright International Education Program for Global Scholars Fellow in Albania. And Dr. Perry has held numerous positions in academic and professional organizations, including the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine's Board on Environmental Studies and Toxicology. And before joining Mason, she was associated with the Milken School of Public Health at George Washington University, Harvard School of Public Health, and the Medical College of Wisconsin. So I'm welcoming Dr. Perry also as a fellow dean, and I'm so appreciative of the fact that we are able to do the celebration as a, you know, across the GMU, and my fellow deans are part of this. And I'm also really honored to welcome Dr. Elliot Sorrell. He's a globally recognized health leader and clinical professor at George Washington University with expertise in health systems performance and global health. He has contributed as an expert to various international health organizations, such as the WHO, NIH, World Bank Group, and OECD. Among his significant achievements, Dr. Sorrell developed the total health model, an integrated approach to primary care, mental health, and public health. He's led pivotal clinical public health research projects and is the author of several influential publications, including 21st Century Global Mental Health. Dr. Sorrell's commitment to advocating for mental health rights and the integration of healthcare has earned him numerous accolades and awards globally, including recognition from Rehabilitation International, the American Psychiatric Association, and the Romanian government. What a delight, what a great opportunity for us to talk about the mental health and well-being contributions of two greatest peacemakers of our times, President and Mrs. Kurtzer. So over to you, and thanks very much for joining us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for that very generous introduction. This is a really exciting moment for us, very exciting. And I can tell you that when Dean Ozerdem invited me to be part of this really important event, it was an absolute yes from the moment that he mentioned it. And I knew it was a critical time to be able to talk to you all anew and to remember the major contributions that President Rosalynn Carter has had in mental health, just remarkable. And I know that those themes have been coming up in the last 2 days, and we're very excited to unpack that with you. Before I get to turn to my beloved and esteemed colleague, who I invited to be part of this because I knew how expert Elliot was in understanding this history, how formative the Carters have been in where we currently are when it comes to mental health in this country. Before I turn to that, let me share a story because our prior panelists were so generous in their stories. I came from rural Vermont, and I was a full Pell scholarship to the University of Vermont. And I was leaving a tiny rural town, and I was very intimidated by coming to the metropolis of Burlington, Vermont. And I had heard of this professor, and he was a psychology professor. And I was really interested in mental health because in my tiny town, there were a lot of mental health problems. There was substance abuse. There was a lot of single parent families. There's a lot of divorce. There was a lot of teen pregnancy. And so I knew I wanted to go into psychology, as a first year aspiring college student knows. And I'd heard about this great professor, and he wrote this article in Psychology Today that I read in my freshman dorm. And it was called "The Answer is Prevention." And his name was George Albee, and he was the past president of the American Psychological Association. And the way in which he got to his point in his career to realize that when it came to the tremendous burden of mental health, emotional, social, psychological health and well-being, that we weren't going to treat our way out of it. And the way he figured that out was through his work on the President's Commission of Mental Health that Jimmy Carter started. So George was very much influenced by this notion of the prevention of mental disorders. And so that was in the 70s. Now, can you imagine talking about prevention when most of the people experiencing mental disorders were all hidden away in institutions? And so George and others were talking about the social causes of mental disorders, and also that it didn't matter how many clinicians that we trained, we'd never be able to contend with the population burden, the number of people that were in need and growing, that those numbers were growing. So George took me under his wing. I reached out to him as part of a program that was Take a Prof to Lunch. So I found the courage to invite George to lunch and told him about my rural background. And in those days, if you were from rural Vermont and you were coming to the University of Vermont, you were considered a woodchuck, which was a disparaging term for rural Vermonters that, you know, were coming out of the woods, out of the mountains. And he just really took a shining to me. And that led to a several decades long experience and collaboration. And it was his work with the Carter Commission that made me aware of the importance of prevention. He was the one that talked me into going into public health rather than into clinical psychology, because the Carters truly understood that in order to recognize and to face the needs of the population, you had to think about community. Yeah. You couldn't think about these institutions where people were hidden away and treated en masse. You had to recognize that all people contending with mental disorders needed to be treated with respect and dignity, and we had to remove stigma. So George taught me, and now I'm going to turn to Elliot in just a moment. George taught me that, and he really had his students learn this phrase, and I've used it many times, and that is that no mass disorder afflicting humankind has ever been brought under control or eliminated by simply attempts at treating the individual. And it made me realize that really prevention and population health was where we needed to go. And so enter Elliot. Elliot and I met at the George Washington University with a shared passion for public mental health. How do we face the needs of our society from a large population perspective? And so I knew for this panel, Elliot, you'd be the perfect person to bring to provide your perspectives. Little did I know how much the Carters influenced your career and how you've evolved with them in many ways over their 15-year impact on mental health. So tell us a little bit more about some of your experiences with the Carters.
Sure. I'll start with a little story, not as long as yours, but similar. I was poised to organize a symposium of the annual meeting of the American Psychiatric Association in 2005 in Atlanta. The symposium was going to focus on one of my passions, namely the area of comorbidity. You know, illnesses do not occur in silence. Most people have two or more illnesses, those who have illnesses. So cardiovascular disorders and depression was a topic I was very excited to organize that year in Atlanta. Then the South Asia tsunami happened, and that derailed my cardiovascular depression. I said, no. I said, we need to focus on this. So I abandoned the original plan. I reached out to my colleagues in the American Psychiatric Association, and I said, we need to deal with this trauma because it cuts across multiple issues, biological, psychological, social, political, etc. And it cuts across geography because at that time, at Christmas 2004, when this happened, there were lots of tens of thousands of North European tourists there. So it didn't affect just South Asian people. It affected many people in Europe as well. So my colleagues at the APA were absolutely thrilled with the idea. And then I thought, I'd like to do this at the Carter Center. Why? Because I was early on inspired. I was a young doctor, just finished my training in psychiatry at Yale. And my first job was to develop a mental health clinic in a family health center. From the very beginning, I did not think mental health should be separate because I truly believe, and I still do, separate means unequal. So ever since my youth, I've always tried to have mental health integrated into the larger good than as a separate special case because that perpetuates stigma. So in those early days, that creed of integration really was my passion. It still is me. So I decided to reach out to the Carters, and they were enthused about the idea. And we mobilized, and I like to work in partnerships. Like I think of integration in terms of health issues, I think of integration and collaboration across disciplines. So we reached out to WHO, reached out to the World Psychiatric Association, to American Psychiatric Association, HHS, and the Carter Center, and we did the symposium. And that was my first brush with the Carters. It was a love at first sight, and it continued. I was inspired by Mrs. Carter's leadership. She was passionate about mental health issues. And it's okay to have advocating one issue, it's okay. But never forget, don't do it separately. Do it in partnership and do it in an integrated fashion. Because if you think about, how does WHO define health? And that should guide us when we think about the integration. Health is a complete state of physical, mental, and social well-being. That's how WHO defines health. Then we should ask the rhetorical question, why should we invest in health? In fact, when I teach my students, and I must tell you, I teach global mental health every year at GW. Last year, none of my students were born in the United States. They're all born somewhere else, but very curious about the United States and very curious about mental health. So when we decided to do this this program with a focus on Banda Aceh and South Asia tsunami,
a number of issues came out of it, one of which a report from the field that is relevant today as well. The WHO colleague who participated was very incensed about the so-called tourism health assistance, or people who fly from Western Europe or from America for 2 or 3 days to assist, and then they leave. It's not a very effective way to intervene. So that was one immediate lessons learned. But to look at the span of what the Carters have done in mental health, I wanted to really take the span of 1963. This year, we celebrate the 60th anniversary of the first president that paid attention to mental health was President Kennedy. In 1963, he did the Community Mental Health Centers Act. But the Carters have been truly most influential because as a result of what they did in late 1970s, followed by Mrs. Carter's testimony, this is the first lady testified at WHO about mental health. Then what followed really emerged, I believe, from partly from President Kennedy's, but mostly from them. We had the Domenici Wellstone Amendment that was in the 1990s. We had also the leading women leaders for mental health that included both Mrs. Carter and Mrs. Ford. Mrs. Ford was courageous enough to face up her substance use problem. And the two of them, Mrs. Carter and Mrs. Ford together, brought together this group of first ladies for mental health and had the privilege of meeting with them at the Pan-American Health Organization in Washington, which is a WHO office for the Americas. In the Clinton administration, I think the Carter influence was felt as well. How do I see that? Well, for the first time in the history of the United States Surgeon General, in 200 years history of a U.S. Surgeon General, there was a report on mental health in 1999. And that was a seminal report, extraordinary report, that brought to light both the benefits of attending to it, not just for those who suffer, but for the whole country. And then in the early 2000s, then the Carters launched in inimitable leadership. They realized that, as the credo of the center says, waging peace, fighting disease, and also attending to well-being, they attended to these issues in a way that realized that one needs to translate this knowledge to a general public and to policymakers. So they established the first international journalism fellowship on mental health. And journalists would spend several weeks at the Carter Center to learn how to present mental health to the public and to policymakers. I'll stop here for a moment.
I love the history, and you lived it. You lived each of those chapters, and I wanted to make sure again when Al asked me about this panel, I just wanted to make sure that everybody recognized how long this evolution has been. So to have the Carters be thinking about these issues in the late 70s, in some ways you may feel, especially since COVID, you may feel that these are new problems and new ideas. But in fact, they were prescient to understand how critically important national policy and very proactive, bold policy was for illuminating issues related to mental health. So if I was doing some research back in the commission report from 1978, here were the cornerstones: community-based care. This was a revolutionary idea. It was a very radical idea. Deinstitutionalization. You can imagine how controversial and how fraught and how much debate there was. Prevention and early intervention. The notion that mental disorders were not just entirely brain diseases that one is born with, or that you're genetically defective and therefore that's why you're mentally ill. Those messages were very, very radical and very groundbreaking. An anti-stigma campaign. I don't know if you know, but Roz Carter's brother, Murray, had schizophrenia. So it was very personal for her. And to take that kind of personal risk as First Lady and say, I'm going to open this up and draw attention to these issues on a national scale was incredibly bold and incredibly courageous. Equal treatment. In many ways, we're still not there. But they were one of the first leaders to broach this topic, to recognize that everyone with a mental illness should receive equal rights and opportunities, including employment, housing, and in order to combat discrimination and prejudice. And then research and data collection. A lot of research came out of the commission and ultimately the act. The kind of research where how do you figure out at any one point in time how many people in the United States are living with a mental disorder? You can go to mental health clinics, you can go to psychiatric hospitals or units, but that's just the people that make it in for care. Think of all of the untreated individuals. That requires community-based research. It requires going house to house and administering surveys. It's some of the work that I did in my graduate studies that George Albee really influenced me to go into, which was psychiatric epidemiology and public mental health. And then finally, education and training. Those were the recommendations in 1978 that ultimately led to the Mental Health Act of 1980. It was very revolutionary. So community mental health, Elliot, how did that resonate with you? How did it inform your training in psychiatry? And I really can appreciate how you've embodied it in your a lifetime of work. But what was it like in those during the 1980s to be influenced by these ideas?
Well, I'll start with a little anecdote. As a medical student, I reached out outside of my school to two psychiatrists that inspired me. Both were Scottish. One was Maxwell Jones, and the other one was Ronnie Lang. And what attracted me to their ideas? Maxwell Jones had been a research physiologist, but in the latter part of his career, he turned from basic physiologic research to looking at social systems. And that was something I was not taught in medical school. I thought, that's quite interesting. So I reached out to him and I spent some time learning and studying with him. And the idea of the impact of social systems that has stayed with me is part of what attracted me to the Carters, because they thought systems. And they saw systems not in silos, but integrated systems. So I was ready as a medical student, instinctively connecting with a scientist who saw the healing power of systems rather than looking at the ills created. And then Rozell Lang was a rebel psychiatrist that was discredited by many of his London colleagues. Why? Because he focused on one system and people felt accused, the family. And I think if one can differentiate the importance of that system and not feel accused that they cause illness, I think it has a great deal of merit, because we need to think about what are the systems that promote health and how can we buttress those systems that promote, protect, and preserve health. Family is one of them. That's where the first events of life happen. That's where I, in recent years, I've become passionate, and I organized in 2018 the first International Choral Congress on Perinatal Total Health. Why did I do that? Because I think illness and health start in utero, not after you're born. What happens in utero is key. In fact, if you think about it, brain development, the most important 3 months are the first three months in utero. Well, the health of the mother and what the mother eats, what the mother drinks, is going to impact that brain. So long before there's social systems or anything else, that system needs to pay attention to. So I think back to Melissa, to your question about community. I think of community in many, many communities. There's a community, the small C is the family, is the first community for a baby, for a child. And when you think about prevention, it's a reference I frequently make to my students. I think prevention, health promotion, health protection, and illness prevention starts in utero and continues the first few weeks and months of life. In fact, babies that can feel their mother's skin can be breastfed. Those are two initial health promoting illness prevention intervention in life. Before there's any illness or any distress, the connectedness, the skin-to-skin connectedness, and the feeding from mom's breasts are two of the most successful in our species of health protection and illness prevention.
It's very, very powerful. I'm just recognizing that in some ways it's intuitive to us to understand this community, the sense of community as a protective ecosystem. And again, getting back to what the way of thinking was in the 1980s, these were very radical ideas for a variety of reasons. Again, the isolation, the stigma, the invisibility of people with mental disorders. For those of you who are old enough to remember this Hallmark movie that Jack Nicholson played in called One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, it was a very powerful portrayal of life inside a psychiatric hospital that the vast majority of Americans had no idea because it was so hidden and so secretive and such a shameful space, almost like the invisibility of people in prison. And so for the Carters to want to not only talk about it, but to really shine a light and to disrupt and to revolutionize how we thought about people in institutions was very, very powerful. The fact that they were able to broach these topics and do it in very credible and long-lasting ways carries with us 45 years later. And as Elliot described, the subsequent policies that came out of the 1980 Act. Now remember, it's really important for you to realize, again, testimony to how radical it was later repealed. First of all, it was underfunded. And so during the Reagan administration, that Mental Health Act was repealed, and it was largely based on how expensive it was. That budgets are tight, we're in a constrained fiscal time, it's going to be too expensive to enact all of this reform. And in part, one could argue that it led to a massive wave of homelessness because we did not fund at the level that the Carters intended the community mental health centers. So the other part I really wanted to mention about the revolutionary concept of community and community mental health was this other side of the argument, which is mental disorders are genetic. They're brain diseases. You're born with that inherent weakness or vulnerability. And I wrote an article, it was in the 90s, and George certainly influenced my thinking about this. I wrote an article about the difference between the social causation model of mental disorders versus the downward drift hypothesis. Downward drift was essentially you were born genetically deficient, hardwired for mental disorders, and therefore socially you drifted down into the lower class because the association between social class and mental disorders are very well established. The social causation model is exactly, I think, the way that the Carters have thought about mental disorders all these years. And that is, it has just what you're saying, Elliot, so much to do with the social opportunities, the resources, community support, familial support, parenting support that one has the privilege of having access to.
Well, I think also Carters had illness in their family and they were willing to deal with it and think in a way that it'll benefit not just their family, but society. And in fact, they were emulated in that respect by two senators, one a Republican and the other one a Democrat. Senator Domenici of New Mexico and Paul Wolfson of Minnesota. And together in the 1990s, they did the Domenici-Wolfson Amendment that for the first time raised the idea not to deal mental illness separately, but parity should be treated as everything else equally. That was very appealing to me. At that time, I was active with the Medical Society of the District of Columbia, and we gave them an award. I personally went to their offices and met with them and gave them their award because my sense was, after having been a young doctor, and by the way, this mental health clinic at a family health center I did was in the West Indies, was for the first time I was in a racial minority. It's a very great learning experience. But meeting with them and thanking them, because I envisioned that though it was a modest beginning, it was an amendment, it was not a law, there were no funds allocated to it, but it was an idea, a spark, that I thought may lead to greater things, and I think they did. What happened? After we had the Surgeon General report in 1999, and then we had parity law, the Domenici-Wellstone parity law. For the first time in the United States, we said, this is not separate. This is equal. It was signed into the law by President Bush and enshrined smartly, not as a separate mental health act. I give credit to the Carters, but President Obama did one up. He inserted this in an integrated fashion into the Affordable Care Act, where mental health became an integral part of total health. I was passionate about it. I participated in President Obama's community meetings. He enlisted us to give ideas. How are we going to roll this out? Once President Bush signed it, now it was up to him to roll it out in his term. And it wasn't easy, and it's still not easy, because what do we have to do? This extraordinary historic act that is deeply rooted in what the Carters started, although theirs was mental health alone, this is comprehensive integrated, but the Carters deserve the credit because they started this ball rolling at the policy level that came full-blown with Domenici-Wellstone. President Bush, truly bipartisan, from Domenici-Wellstone, Bush, Obama, and then Assaults to Kill, twice before the United States Supreme Court to abolish the Affordable Care Act. I'm happy to report to you I was a happy warrior and a co-signatory of the amicus curiae for the United States Supreme Court regarding the assault on the Affordable Care Act, and we prevailed both times. I would not be surprised that it may be attacked again. I don't understand, frankly. I'm trying to understand, and it's hard for me to grapple with this. This is such a common sense thing. It's not a separate thing. The latest scientific evidence indicates pre-pandemic, the predictions were that 1 in 4 in the world will have a mental illness before age 75. Guess what the prediction is now? Post-pandemic, though we're not quite out of post, not quite in post. We're kind of in an endemic state. 1 in 2 before 75. So to keep on holding mental illness separate, it hurts everybody. To give you one more piece of evidence that I'll make it available afterwards. You remember the economic crisis of 2008. Economies tanked. America didn't do as badly as the rest of the world, but we didn't do well either. So in 2009 and 2010, all of a sudden, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development in Europe got shocked with the tab they had to pay for disability. So the economy started to analyze the data. What is going on here? It's like a tsunami of disabilities they had to pay. And when they found out, most of the disabilities they were paying were for mental illness post the economic crash. So the economy said, they surrendered. We know nothing about mental illness. Let's get a group of people who know something. And I was privileged to be one of 12 doctors from around the world to work with OECD, to look at the data, and to come up with an analysis and some recommendations. I'm happy to share that document with you. It's called Making Mental Health Count. Because it's not just about health and illness. It's also about the country's economies. This is where you need to think holistically, integratively, as the Carters did. And that is so relevant, not only for maintaining complete state of well-being, physical, mental, social, but also it undermines the economic fabric of society if we do not attend to it. There is a concept in our field called presenteeism. What is presenteeism? Presenteeism refers to people who are at work, but they're working at 60% capacity. Why? Because they have untreated mental illnesses or other illnesses. So because of all these issues, and because the credit that the Carters were deserved to start this going, we now have the knowledge of what are the various elements why this should be part of an Affordable Care Act as it is. And to ask why, my students asked me, as I said, mostly from not born here, I said, doctor, how come there's so much discrimination, although there's great discrimination in other parts of the world as well. But I think I give them the example of how does the United States Congress deal with budgetary allocation with two items, the military and health. When it comes to the military, it's referred to as an investment. When it refers to health, it's a cost. Well, we need to invest. Health is an investment.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We had planned on having a dialogue with the audience. I really want to hear your comments, questions, and recollections. Before we do that, one provocative question I'm going to spring on you, Elliot. If we could ask President and Rosalynn Carter to give the country a grade for how we've done in advancing issues related to the support of and prevention of mental health mental disorders, what kind of grade do you think they would give us?
Probably C minus.
Okay.
But I want to add one more thing. I think America is a fantastic country. We have all the resources to move this forward. We need, though, the political will to do so. And we need to treat mental health not separately. Separate is unequal. It has to be, this Affordable Care Act is the model. And the brain is the model. Because, you know, this is the integrator. All the other gadgets that are being developed are based on this model. Mm-hmm. So we need to think about making the most of it. And I think that kind of impetus is required. Before I go to the question Q&A, I just want to present a little gift my friend here, and relevant to what we're talking about. A few years back, I wrote one of my books on titled 21st Century Global Mental Health. And I thought that this book that will be addressed to was intended for public health students, they should know the importance of translating scientific evidence in the field to those who make decisions. And that was the idea that I was inspired by the Carters, by the International Journalism Fellowship in Mental Health. So a chapter in my book is done by the Carter people on the international mental health leadership. So I want to give this to the dean and her students, and with a little dedication that I said to Dean Melissa J. Perry, George Mason University, students and faculty, sincerely, Elliot Sroy.
Thank you so much, Elliot.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I'm very excited to read it and to share it with students as well.
Great.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Daniel Rothbart, faculty at the Carter School. Thank you so much, Dr. Sorrell, for your insights, and Dean Perry. As you know, the Carter School focuses on different forms of violence. And there's a lot of talk these days about the mental health basis of the violence of, you know, the mass shooters and so on. And so what, and also, so that's one question. And related is the mental health implications, that is the impact. So, you know, going from the cause to the shooter, and then from the shooter, that episode, to the possible mental health impact, trauma, or whatever the proper term is. So what, I know that's a big question, so what is your insight about that?
Well, first I'd like to make a reference for you, since you're a faculty, you'd like to be connected with some scientific evidence. You know, research on violence in the United States, support from the government ceased in 1992. I think it's being tried to be revived. I hope the Biden administration will be successful, though more than this dysfunctional Congress. But we know that mentally ill people are not more violent than the rest, except exception, those who are not severely ill and not in treatment. So ill, untreated, yes, they're more likely to be involved in erratic acts. But mentally ill people in treatment are not. In fact, most of the violent acts are not committed by mentally ill people. And in fact, access to guns is a major source of the problem. And we keep on sort of burying our head in the sand, making believe that, oh, guns is just a Second Amendment right. Well, the right to keep on killing and killing is not in the Constitution. I think that, to take one example, another country where guns abound, what country is that? Switzerland. If you are 41-year-old man who've already served in the army in Switzerland, you have a gun at home because you're always part of the Swiss army. There's not much shootings in Switzerland. Plenty of guns. There are guns in every home in Switzerland. So it is really an issue here. We are the most armed country in the world. We have over 300 million guns in the homes of the United States. So I don't have any, I'm not optimistic that we'll be able to pass any legislation in this Congress about this. But I think we need some legislation, and I think we need a campaign to show the scientific evidence. So, you know, we are traversing a very weird space in the world. There's a huge anti-science movement, and scientific evidence is not anymore carrying the weight that it used to carry. So it's almost like science has to reclaim its credibility. The lack of credibility in scientific evidence empowers the naysayers to prevent any effective legislation at the moment. So a bit stuck. I'm sorry I can't give you a more optimistic message, but I think this is the reality we have to deal with.
I completely agree. Absolutely. I would echo everything that you just said, Elliot. Daniel, we had the pleasure of convening a panel last spring at the College of Public Health, where we brought together a variety of different perspectives, including yours from a peacemaking perspective. We had a social worker, we had an anthropologist, we had a pediatric public health expert. And continuously communing the conversation is absolutely necessary. I think about the anti-science movement and still believe, perhaps naively, Pollyannishly, that what gets counted counts. And again, looking back at the mental health legislation from the Carters in 1980, research and training was a hallmark of that bill. They understood how critical it was to do the systematic assessment of the burden of mental disorders. And so too is the necessity. We have hidden the gun problem by not doing any research on it, by forbidding research on it. So that is a really important step. Another comment or question?
Yeah. I am Mark Copen. Thank you so much. There's so much I learned from both of you. Just a question on this question of persuasion and social change on policy and looking at the sources of what is the resistance to mental health exactly, and where does it fit along the lines of partisanship and conservative and liberal spectrum? To what degree are we doing any soul searching about? I'm privy to a lot of very conservative movements and religions, and it's amazing to me how much work they're doing on family health, as if psychotherapy is the alternative that is unacceptable. So, in other words, they're very aware of family health and family relationships problems, but they're loath to go to the traditional theory. So we know that in the history of psychology, a lot of the blame, it was blame focused, it was problem focused, and very much to parents very often. And you know that's shifting. I'm not, you know. The question is there some sort of conflict analysis and trust building alternatives to integrating mental health into a broad spectrum of American political thinking? And the second part of that is, can we make it profitable to those who are benefiting from no mental health and a lot of drugs, you know, as an alternative? Because there's great profits in not healing any of this in terms of people getting addicted to painkillers and many other unhealthy forms of coping.
You raised some very complicated dimensions to this problem. I'm just going to comment briefly and then turn to Dr. Sorrell, because I'm sure you have some deep thoughts about this as well. It has been fascinating. Again, I was reflecting in preparation for this panel to think about what was happening in the 70s. And again, the notion of deinstitutionalization and stigma and revealing mental disorders and really facing them and how hidden they were. What happened later, afterward, was during the Reagan administration, it wasn't just budget cuts. It was also this notion of government mandating that the entire country go deinstitutionalize and that these community mental health centers at a federal level must be funded. So Reagan Republicans would say, no, let's the states figure it out. No, don't have the government in the intimate lives of people. So there was a politicization, but I also mentioned this notion of deficit. And what happened in the 90s was the decade of the brain. And that was the promise where we plowed millions of dollars into NIH and other federal programs to uncover the genes that were causing schizophrenia, that were causing mental disorders, that were causing substance abuse. Did it deliver the answer? No. Am I saying that mental disorders are not genetically influenced? I'm not saying that. We're not in that simple-minded dichotomy of nature versus nurture, but there was a attractiveness to that simple answer, and that was it's in your genes. So that, too, is influenced, I think, politically. But what you mentioned in terms of the commodification of the treatment of mental disorders, that has been a struggle among wellness advocates, among community mental health advocates, among people living with mental disorders, and among psychiatrists and psychologists in terms of prescription rights as well. So I think we're always looking for an easy answer. That's my simple-minded synopsis. We're always looking for an easy answer to mental disorders.
I think we're on a very interesting and unprecedented cusp of paradigm shifts, multiple paradigm shifts. I'll pass cut to one of them, the challenge you now have of AI and ChatGPT. That is going to speed, properly utilized AI can help us uncover the mystery of the brain that has never been uncovered. Our knowledge of the brain, we know only about 15% of what the brain can do. I'm not suggesting reductionistically that all health and illness is about the brain, but unless we understand thoroughly the brain, the rest is bumbling. So We now know, for instance, that like the Carter's ingenious integrative approach, the brain is an integrator and it does not function on its own. In fact, we discovered, for instance, you know, I was born in Romania. When I first came to this country, I heard this expression, I have a gut feeling. I said, my God, how could you have a gut feeling? This was in my youth, my 20s in America. Now I understand, yes, the gut, the microbiome, in fact, has a direct link with the brain. And at times, we might not even know which one prevails in what situations. It's a mystery, but it's a mystery, intriguing mystery, that we're just discovering. Additionally, we thought that the genome is the genome. Follow the genome and you got the secret. Wrong, reductionistic, 19th century thinking. Our bodies do not work in silos. It's an integrated system. So understanding, I'm very passionate about four dimensions, the brain, the immune system, the genome, and the gut. These four dimensions are not well understood how they interact with each other. Again, I'm hoping that although we go through a spat of anti-science advocacy, we will prevail and be able to discover some of these mysteries and not forget and not think that it's all about genes and biology. The social context will have to be taken into account. But it is in this realm of multiple integrative, systemic, systematic, integrative approaches that science has not yet developed, because we have a model of scientific evidence search reductionistically that is antithetical to what life is. So that's why we're caught in these chasms of no wins, that the question that you're raising. I hope that we're able to manage smartly this time AI and help AI as an ally to help us speed this process of understanding to a better future. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you very much.